Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. Good morning.
Morning.
Your weekly morning reminder. Hopefully happy. You're always happy to see me. Oh boy, here comes Neil with our reminders, right? That's how I take it from all you, especially you, Den. That smile you give me. Yep, thumbs up. Spectacular. As always, your reminder for the tear off is not just there for our entertainment or to drive your neighbors crazy as you slowly tear it off, as I sometimes do for no reason. But it is to fill out if you're a first time, second time, third time guest, especially. You can fill one out, take it to the Welcome Center. For that, we'll give you lovely gifts, just because then we will be sending you emails. So that's the trade-off. And then on the other side for prayer requests are there. You can put you can write down any prayer requests you have. You can put them in our boxes on our way out, and they will get prayed for by staff for at least that next week. And that's not something we send out email-wise. If you want to send out emails, you could also do that on the prayer request and just write, to email it out. And probably Tina would get a hold of you just to make sure. But it's there for you. We don't just do it for my entertainment of ripping off the tear-offs. And then, like Rocky said last week, baptisms are coming up, those types of things. If you're interested in any of those on the right, you just fill one off, mark it, and we'll get a hold of you. Inside your bulletins, if you want to open up with me this morning, always packed, hopefully full of everything's relevant, good information, but some that we're going to point out this morning. Fresh Food is next Saturday, Fresh Food Initiative. So if you are a normal helper, if you know you're not going to be here, if you could let me know, but if you know you are going to be here, that would be helpful. If helping is something that you've always thought, well, I wouldn't mind helping out with Fresh Food, talk to me in between services and I'll let you know. It's an easy, fun couple hours. It's not even actually a couple hours. It's a fun hour. KC Moms below that is starting, and there's information there. September 1st, pre-register by September 1st, coming September 17th. And then if you go to the right, the Heritage Day celebration, the cookbook information. Look at the Heritage Day celebrating 150 years. We do not want somebody coming up later and going, I didn't know there was going to be a cookbook. I would have put Great Aunt Rosie's whatever in there. So there it is. There's your information. Cookbooks. If you have a recipe you want to get in, I don't know how that works. Like if all recipes just go automatically get in, where's Jamie? Yeah, I was going to say, like, right, Cinnamon Toast Crunch, and you just add milk. I don't know how it works, but send them in, and they'll maybe get them in there. I'm not going to guarantee that. And then KC Women kicks off. If you were a woman and you're looking forward to KC Women kicking off, like I know most of you are, yes, exactly, September 9th. So really, everything in there is in there for your information, but it's not there just so that you have something to stare at and doodle over and scroll through, and then later say, like, oh, I didn't know anything about KC Women. So just look at it, right, Gary? All right, there's my rambling for the week. I'm sure you're as happy to have that done as I am. So pray with me this morning. Lord God, we thank you. We thank you for our time together. We thank you for our fellowship time together, talking for and between services, Lord, but that's not what we're here for. We are here for you. We are here to worship your name. We are here to sing songs of praise to you, to worship your name during the word, to learn from you, to get wisdom from you. For all those things, Lord, we are here for you. So this morning, bless our time together. Bless our time singing praise songs. Bless the worship team to lead us and help us to sing out to you like no one else is listening, just to sing from our heart to you, Lord. And then when it comes to the word, Lord, we pray and we thank you that for the wisdom you've given Rocky to give us this word. And we pray that you use him this morning as an awesome, greatly fine tool to deliver it to us. But we pray that our ears are open, that our hearts are open to hear what it is that you are speaking to each and every one of us. Not just to hear, like we always say, not just to hear it and then say, oh, that's great information, Lord, thanks. But to hear it and apply it to our lives, to live it out so that we look more like you to everyone we come into contact with. Lord, bless our time together this morning. Your son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you can stand and join the worship team.
me you, Lord. You are my best thought by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, your presence, my life.
Test or trial or pain, there is a faith proved of more worth than gold. So refine me, Lord, through the flame. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. This is my prayer in the battle, when triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on His promise I'll stand. Prayer in the harvest, when favor and providence flow, I know I'm filled to be emptied again. The seed I've received I will sow.
Father, this morning we come to You in Jesus' name. Through Your Holy Spirit we approach Your throne. What an amazing privilege it is that we can approach You and that You hear us, that You would take the time for us. Lord, we don't understand all of that. We don't understand the why, but we believe it's true. We thank You that we don't have to walk alone in this life. In the desert moments, You're with us. In the valley moments, You walk with us. On the mountaintops, You're there. We are not alone. Lord, there are moments when we feel alone, when we feel like we're isolated, we're out where nobody knows where we are, nobody even cares, but the reality is You do. Thank You. Your word tells us to bring a sacrifice of thanksgiving. We thank You that You are the God who walks with us the God who prepares the way for us, the God who provides all that we need. You are an amazing, amazing God. Father, this morning we want to thank you for allowing us to gather here to lift you up, to enjoy fellowship with one another, to hear your word. And I ask this morning that your Holy Spirit will speak through me, and that each one who is hearing will be sensitive to your voice. Lord, as we share your word, we ask that you will guard my lips from saying anything that would not be accurate, and guard the ears of our hearers that they would only hear your truth. We lift up our children's ministry, as in a moment they will be going to the children's area and hearing your word again. Lord, would you speak through each volunteer and each one who's presenting the lesson today? Lord, thank you for loving us. Draw us close to you. And Lord, our commitment is that we will follow you. We love you, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I want to share with you a message this morning entitled The Wilderness and Faith Witness. We began this short series, a four-week series last Sunday called Lessons from the Wilderness. And we looked at this question last week. How does God use wilderness in our lives? And we looked at a passage of scripture in Deuteronomy, and we discovered three things that God does as we're in the wilderness, how he uses the wilderness. First of all, we learned that he uses the wilderness to humble us. And each of us have some area of pride in our lives that God works on. And often the wilderness is one of those places that he uses that really takes some of that pride out of us. God also uses the wilderness to test us. And we said the question that God asked us is, do you trust me? Do you trust me? And it's in the wilderness where God tests us to see if we will walk his way. And then we also discovered that God uses the wilderness to teach us. To teach us primarily that he is all we need, that no one can satisfy us, no one can provide for us like he does. Now this morning, as we take the next step, we want to look at this question. How does the wilderness impact us? How does it affect us? And does it have anything to do with demonstrating whether or not we have faith, or what kind of witness our faith is to those around us? A few other questions that I just want to bring to the forefront this morning is this. Can the wilderness strengthen our faith? Can those wilderness moments, the desert times, can it be something that is very beneficial to our faith? Can my faith witness in the wilderness encourage others? As others watch me, as they observe me, as they observe you going through those wilderness moments, can it be an encouragement to them? And then this question, what do people see in my life as I walk through the wilderness? What do they see in my life as I walk through the wilderness? We're going to try to address some of those questions through the message. And so this morning, I want to invite you to take a journey with me back about 3,000 years. We're going to visit a place called Bethlehem. We're going to spend some time in the wilderness and observe a well-known Bible character and his wilderness experiences, one of them. This individual, this character, is very familiar with the wilderness. He spent some time there, and his understanding of the wilderness was key to his survival in the many times he was there. As we read his life story, we discover that the wilderness was a frequent place for him to visit, but not always by his own choosing, Because you see, in the story we're going to share today from the scripture, he was being chased like a lion chasing his prey by a man named Saul. This character you know as David. He's a very familiar character. And as we look at a particular incident in his life, a wilderness incident, we're going to discover that his response in the wilderness is a good example for us as we face the wilderness times in our lives. So if your Bibles are open, we want to read 1 Samuel chapter 24. And I'm going to read the entire chapter of 22 verses. So follow along with us this morning, please. 1 Samuel 24, verse 1. After Saul returned from pursuing the Philistines, he was told, David is in the desert of En-Gedi. So Saul took 3,000 chosen men from all Israel and set out to look for David and his men near the crags of the wild goats. He came to the sheep pens along the way. A cave was there, and Saul went in to relieve himself. David and his men were far back in the cave. The men said, "This is the day the Lord spoke of when he said to you, 'I will give your enemy into your hands for you to deal with as you wish.'" Pause for a moment. God never said that. David's men were saying that to David, okay, just so you know that. Then David crept up unnoticed and cut off a corner of Saul's robe. Afterward, David was conscience-stricken for having cut off a corner of his robe. He said to his men, "The Lord forbid that I should do such a thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, or lift my hand against him, for he is the anointed of the Lord." With these words, David rebuked his men and did not allow them to attack Saul. And Saul left the cave and went his way. Then David went out of the cave and called out to Saul, "My Lord, the king." When Saul looked behind him, David bowed down and prostrated himself with his face to the ground. He said to Saul, "Why do you listen when men say, 'David has been on harming you'? This day you have seen with your own eyes how the Lord delivered you into my hands in the cave. Some urged me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, 'I will not lift my hand against my master because he is the Lord's anointed.' See, my father, look at this piece of your robe in my hand. I cut off the corner of your robe, but did not kill you. Now understand and recognize that I am not guilty of wrongdoing or rebellion. I have not wronged you, but you are hunting me down to take my life. May the Lord judge between you and me, and may the Lord avenge the wrongs you have done to me. But my hand will not touch you. As the old saying goes, from evildoers come evil deeds, so my hand will not touch you. Against whom has the king of Israel come out? Whom are you pursuing? A dead dog? A flea? May the Lord be our judge and decide between us. May he consider my cause and uphold it. May he vindicate me by delivering me from your hand." When David finished saying this, Saul asked, "Is that your voice, David, my son?" And he wept aloud. "You are more righteous than I," he said. "You have treated me well, but I have treated you badly. You have just now told me of the good you did to me. The Lord delivered me into your hands, but you did not kill me. When a man finds his enemy, does he let him get away unharmed? May the Lord reward you well for the way you treated me today. I know that you will surely be king, and that the kingdom of Israel will be established in your hands. Now swear to me by the Lord that you will not cut off my descendants or wipe out my name from my father's family." So David gave his oath to Saul. Then Saul returned home, but David and his men went up into the stronghold. That is 1 Samuel chapter 24. I think in order for us to really grasp where we are in this story today, we need to look at a little bit of the backstory. So let's go back a few hundred years, not too many. And let's go all the way back to the time when Israel was delivered from Egypt. You know the story. They had been enslaved for 400 years. God raises up Moses. Moses leads them out of Egypt into the desert, and ultimately to the border of the promised land, the land of Canaan. They sent spies in. The spies came back with a bad report. 10 of the 12 says, we can't do this. They disobeyed God. God said, for 40 years then, you're going to wander in the wilderness. Moses, in the midst of the wilderness, disobeys God, and God says, Moses, you won't go into the land. Someone else will lead them in. Moses dies. Joshua then has the privilege and the responsibility of leading Israel to conquer Canaan. They crossed the Jordan River. They took down Jericho. How did they do it? By atomic bombs, right? No, they walked around the city once a day for 7 days, and on the seventh day, they walked around it seven times. They blew trumpets, they shouted, and the walls fell down. God brought a deliverance there. That was the first city. Over the next few years, they took over the land. They conquered the land of Canaan. There came a time when Israel was led by the prophets and by judges. They were the spiritual leaders and gave guidance and led them in various war endeavors, taking over the land. We come to a man named Samuel. He was a prophet and a judge. He was the last judge. And he was a godly man. There came a time when the people of Israel said, we want a king like all the people around us. You see, up to this point, God had been their leader through the prophets and through the judges. And now they looked around at the nations and they said, we want something like they have. And this really troubled Samuel. And he called out to God and said, God, I don't like this. I don't think this is right. But God says, go ahead, let them have a king. Samuel was given divine instruction. And there was a man by the name of Saul. And we find that this man, Saul, this young man who was about 30 years of age, was anointed by Saul to be the first king, or by Samuel to be the first king of Israel. Now, his reign began very well. He walked humbly before God. He did what God said at first. And then what we discover as we walk through the story is that pride surfaced. There came a time when they were preparing to go into battle and there was a sacrifice that was to be made and he was waiting on Samuel and Samuel seemed to delay. And so Saul took over and did something he should not have done. He offered a sacrifice that was not for him to offer. I need to do this. And then not long after that, God told him, you need to go to battle against the Amalekites, and I want you to totally destroy the Amalekites. Don't spare anyone or anything. Saul goes out to battle. And in direct disobedience, they spared the king. They spared the best animals, the cows, the sheep, the best. Samuel confronts Saul with this, and Saul tries to pass the buck. Well, the men, they wanted to do this. God, through Samuel, says, God has rejected you, Saul, as king of Israel. Someone will be raised up and will take your place. God rejected him. Then God says, Samuel, I have another task for you. You're to anoint the next king. Well, what do I do that, God? God says, go to Bethlehem. Go to Bethlehem. Samuel arrives in Bethlehem, and God directs him to the house of a man by the name of Jesse. Jesse had 8 sons. God says to Samuel, one of these sons is going to be the king. And so Samuel asks Jesse to have each son come before him. And one after the other, God said, not that one, not that one, not that one. And they went through seven of the sons, and Samuel says, Jesse, do you have any more sons? Yeah, I've got one more. He's young. He's out in the fields watching the sheep. Go get him. We're not going to have a supper here until he shows up. And when this young man walks in, God said, that's the one. And Samuel anointed David as the next king of Israel. Now, he didn't become king at that moment. In fact, as we read through the scripture, his journey to the throne was rather eventful. We find this experience. We find him facing the 9-foot-tall Philistine Goliath. And we know that David had an automatic weapon, and he had everything he needed, right? Yeah. No, he had a sling and 5 stones against a fully armored Philistine warrior. David runs at Goliath, and we know he begins to wind up that sling. Don't look, it wasn't that little beanie shooter thing, you know. This is the sling. And God directed that stone to the forehead of Goliath, and he falls to the ground. David grabs the sword with 2 hands and whacks Goliath's head off. As a result of this, Saul, the king, says, I'll give you my daughter to be your wife. And ultimately, David becomes the son-in-law of Saul, the king. David was sent out on various war adventures, and he would come back victorious every time he went out into battle. And there was one occasion as David comes into town, the ladies in the town begin to cheer. Saul has slain thousands, but David has killed tens of thousands. And Saul's jealousy began to rise at that point. And Saul began looking for opportunities to take David's life. We know that there were many occasions where Saul threw his spear at David, trying to pin him against the wall. And finally, David fled the kingdom, and Saul began to chase him and chased him into the wilderness on multiple occasions. And that's where we're going to spend our time, because this story that we read from 1 Samuel 24 is centered in the wilderness. Let me just give you an aerial view of the area that we're talking about. If you look at this map on the screen, in the upper portion near the left, we see the yellow star. There is Jerusalem. And then I have En Gedi that is circled down near the Dead Sea. And as you can see from this satellite image, this is all desert. This is the Judean wilderness. Now, to give you a little bit of an idea of distance, there is actually a highway that runs from Jerusalem, and it goes east and then comes down to En Gedi. That's about a 50-mile journey by car. As the crow flies, it's about 20 miles. And we understand that these men, the king, would not have taken the highway because it wasn't there. They're going to go over rough terrain. So they're in the desert. And in this wilderness, we have to go back to chapter 23, and we discover a few things. So prepare to look at 23 in just a moment. I want to give you just a little bit more about this place called En Gedi. It's an oasis in the desert. It's a place that if you were going through the Judean wilderness that you would look for. In times past, there was a town there named En Gedi, and it's also referred to in another location in the Old Testament as Hazazon Tamar, same place. There was a city there, which is perfect because you have a water supply and you have the ability, because of the water, to grow a few crops and to sustain life there. In the place called En Gedi today, There are a couple falls and springs. These are what are called the lower falls. And as you come up from the Dead Sea and into this oasis, you begin making a little journey upward, and you come to this stream, this little fall. And then as you continue your way up, you come to what is known as the Upper Falls. I don't recall how many feet this is, but it's not a huge waterfall as far as volume of water, but it's a beautiful place, and it's a nice, cool place after you've walked back in, and we were privileged to be there. Now, let me give you kind of a panoramic view of this same waterfall. You see the ruggedness around it, but then you see the green where the water is. Now, I want you to imagine you're standing looking at this particular scene, and then you do a 180 and you look behind you. This is your view. You have the Dead Sea in the background, and then the mountains on the other side of the Dead Sea is the land of Jordan. It's very rugged. It's a very beautiful, beautiful place. This is the region that we find David hiding from Saul. Now, if you will, I want you to just notice a couple other details. Not only is it an oasis in the desert, but there were caves around, and often they were used to shelter sheep in the caves. The shepherds would bring the sheep out, and then they would find a place in the evening time to put them in a safe place. That plays into the story because Saul goes into an area that was a cave used as a sheep pen. It's also a place of refuge from enemies because there were so many caves. If you were fleeing from somebody, you could find a random cave, and there were so many of them, who's going to find you? This is where we find David. So look at the end of chapter 23. We find David in a very precarious position. Verse 26 of chapter 23, Saul was going along one side of the mountain, and David and his men were on the other side, hurrying to get away from Saul. As Saul and his forces were closing in on David and his men to capture them, a messenger came to Saul, saying, "Come quickly, the Philistines are raiding the land." Then Saul broke off his pursuit of David and went to meet the Philistines. That is why they call this place Selah Hamalekoth. And David went up from there and lived in the strongholds of En-Gedi. So here we are. David's in this location. He's hiding from Saul. Now we find Saul taking care of business, national business. He deterred the Philistines. And somebody says, Saul, David is at En-Gedi. This stirred everything up. Saul gathered 3,000 of his soldiers. In fact, if you look at verse 2 of chapter 24, 3,000 chosen men. Maybe these were his special forces. And he begins pursuing David again. He just won't let up. You saw the aerial, the satellite view, and recognize that the wilderness is a very rugged place. The wilderness is a hot place. The wilderness is a challenging place to travel. And so the scripture tells us, as we read this morning, that as they neared this place, they came to the sheep pens along the way. There was a cave there. Saul went in to relieve himself. Okay, I know what you're thinking. And you're right. Okay? But to relieve himself probably had twofold meaning. He probably had to go to the bathroom, okay? But it was hot. You go into a cave, it's cool in there. Maybe he needed to rest. And so we find Saul going into a cave to either or relieve himself, go to the bathroom, and to rest a little bit, get out of the heat. And he chooses a particular location where sheep had been held. And it was a very large place. What he didn't know was that way back in the cave was David and his men. Imagine for a moment, you're David and his men, and you look towards the entrance and it's light out, you're in the dark, and you see this figure enter the cave and you're like, no way. King Saul. And he's alone. Maybe you turned your eyes as he took off his outer robe and he relieved himself. And maybe we don't know exactly all the details here, but perhaps he had laid that robe aside, the outer robe aside, and maybe he sat down or maybe even laid down to rest. And David's men were like, you hit the jackpot, buddy. Look at this. Perfect opportunity. Here's this dude that's chasing you. He's trying to kill you. He's by himself. He doesn't have any clue that we're here. Nobody will know. Go get him. God's put him into your hands. How tempting do you think that might have been? It's because David knew he was the next king. Maybe he could rush the plan a little bit. Take him out. We find David slowly, silently creeping closer and closer. And the scripture tells us that David cut a piece of Saul's robe and then made his way back to his men. But as he made his way back, his conscience began to bother him. Now, he hadn't touched Saul. He hadn't harmed Saul. But what he had done was very disrespectful. Nobody would do something to damage the king's possessions, let alone his robe. And as he gets back to his men, I think his men were cheering and going, come on, David, you can do this. But when he gets back to his men, look what he says in verse 6. He said to his men, the Lord forbid that I should do such a thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, or lift up my hand against him, for he is the anointed of the Lord. And David refused to let his men attack Saul. As we read on, Saul leaves the cave. And when he gets a little distance away, David steps out and he calls out to Saul. We read it to you before, but listen again. 1 Samuel 24:9. He said to Saul, why do you listen to men? Why do you listen when men say, David has been on harming you? This day you have seen with your own eyes how the Lord delivered you into my hands in the cave. Some urged me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, I will not lift up my hand against my master because he is the Lord's anointed. See, my father, look at this piece of your robe in my hand. I cut off the corner of your robe, but did not kill you. Now understand and recognize that I am not guilty of wrongdoing or rebellion. I have not wronged you, but you are hunting me down to take my life. May the Lord judge between you and me, and may the Lord avenge the wrongs you have done to me, but my hand will not touch you. As the old saying goes, from evildoers come evil deeds, so my hand will not touch you. Against whom has the king come out? Whom are you pursuing, a dead dog, a flea? May the Lord be our judge and decide between us. May he consider my cause and uphold it. May he vindicate me by delivering me from your hand. We see Saul's response. It says that he wept aloud. Were they real tears or were they crocodile tears? I would suggest to you that in the moment, they were real because Saul realized just how close he was to being killed and it sobered him. But we know, as we read a little later on, he kept up the pursuit a little bit later. And Saul asked David to spare his family. He says, I know you're going to be the next king. Please spare my family. Don't wipe out my family. And David said, I give you my word, Saul. I will not wipe out your family. Saul returns with his men to Jerusalem. David and his men stay there at En Gedi. That's Saul or David's wilderness experience, one of them. And I believe there are some lessons, two lessons that I want to share with us this morning that we can learn from David. First of all, we learn this. David trusted God in the wilderness. David trusted God in the wilderness. Listen to how he did it. He knew he would be the next king. He already knew that. But no time frame was given. When Samuel anointed David, he didn't say in 3 years, in 6 years, and he just says, you're the next king. David had opportunity to fast forward this by taking Saul's life. But did David do it? No. We find David waiting and trusting. David waited and trusted. Somehow it seems that David believed that in God's time, God would fulfill his promise that he would be king. Oh, it was tempting. Dave was human, just like we are. You know that it had to be tempting. I could take him out now. I'll be the king. What we don't know is, if David would have done that, what would have been the ramifications of it? Could it possibly have disqualified him from being the next king? Could it be that those who would have been supportive of Saul would have rebelled or rejected David's kingship once they found out David took Saul's life? What were the results of this? Could it have been that Saul or that David's kingdom would have really been troubled because of taking someone else's life wrongly? We don't know. All we know is David waited and he trusted. God said he was going to take care of it. God said he was going to provide. God said he was going to be the next king. And he says, I'm not going to take it into my own hands. It seems to me that this is a great example for us to follow when we're in our wilderness. Wait and trust. How easy is waiting? We want to get out of the wilderness as soon as we can. I mean, it's hard, it's ugly, it's rugged, it's painful, it's difficult, whatever adjectives you want. And when we look around and we go, how can I get out of here? And we're looking, how can I, oh, maybe here's a way to do it. And we try to take matters into our own hands, and what do? We mess things up. What would happen if in the midst of our wilderness, we waited and trusted God to do what he does best? What does God tell us? We sang about it this morning. We don't walk alone. He's with us. God promises he will provide for us. What would happen if we just waited and trusted and didn't try to fast forward? But say, God, in your time, I'm trusting you. The second lesson that I see from David is this. David had a proper attitude in the wilderness. He cut the robe off, or a portion of Saul's robe off, and he was tender in conscience. He was like, oh, I should not have done that. That wasn't the right thing to do. That wasn't the right step to take. We see that he was not only tender in conscience, but he had an attitude of forgiveness, not bitterness. And if anybody had a human right to be bitter, angry, and all of that stuff, it would be David. I mean, he's being chased around the desert. He's being chased not just by anybody, but by his father-in-law. You know those in-laws. David, from a human perspective, had every reason to take him out. And yet he said, no. And I wonder if one of the reasons David had this proper attitude was that he recognized that there were 600 men who were watching him, and that he would have an influence by the way he responded on them and how they might respond in a situation. David had a proper attitude. He was waiting, he was trusting, and he was gentle in the midst of the wilderness, which makes me ask this question of us. When we are walking through the wilderness, what do people see in us? We must understand that when you and I walk through the wilderness, people are watching. And the way we respond in the wilderness says something about our faith. It's a faith witness, or an indication that we don't have faith, that we're not trusting God. Our children are watching. Our families are watching. Our coworkers are watching. Our fellow believers are watching as we walk through the wilderness. What do they see? What do they see? David's men saw a man who was forgiving, a man who was not trying to rush the program, a man who was willing to wait on God's time. As I thought about this, two men came to mind that most of you in this congregation know. These two men were part of our congregation. Both of these men loved Jesus. Both of these men were in a battle of cancer. Both of these men fought hard in this battle. I'm talking about Steve Leonard and Skip Kader. Both of these men, in the midst of the battle, were watched by us. And what did we see? Did we see bitterness? Did we see anger? Did we see them striking out? Did we see them acting in ways other than faith? I'm not saying they were perfect. I'm certain that there were moments when they were just at the bottom. They didn't feel good. But what they demonstrated to us was a genuine trust in God. And there was this, yes, we want to beat this, but if not, we're going to heaven. And they demonstrated a sweet spirit through all that they went through. And you know, today, they're both in heaven. They're both in heaven. They're receiving their reward. And I don't know if some of you remember, but back in the center section, there was one day near the end of, I don't remember which one it was, but both of them were near the end, and they sat right back here in this sanctuary, and they were just chatting back and forth. I wish I knew what they were talking about. I wouldn't be surprised if they were talking about what was next. These men, they demonstrated faith. There was a faith witness that we observed in their lives in the wilderness. Let me wrap up with this. Wilderness is a place for us to wait and trust. Boy, we don't like that. But may God help us to pray something like this. Lord, help me wait. Help me trust that you will get me out of the wilderness at the right time. You've heard us talk about surrender, haven't you? That's really what we're talking about here, saying, God, I'm in your hands. Do with me whenever, whatever, however. In the wilderness, we find it's a place to wait and trust. And secondly, we learn this in the wilderness. The wilderness exposes who we are. Oh, would it be said of us when we walk through the wilderness. Wow. There is something different about that person. Their wilderness experience hasn't caused them to be cynical or bitter or angry. They have kept a sweet spirit in the midst of the wilderness. The wilderness will expose us for who we are. I would declare to us this morning that wilderness truly is an illustration of faith witness. What are people going to see in your life as you walk through wilderness? A faith witness? With God's help, the answer can be yes. Let's pray. Lord, we confess to you this morning that we don't like the wilderness. It's painful. It hurts. But sometimes it seems like we're there forever and there's no hope of getting out of it. May we be people like David who waited and trusted, not trying to take matters into our own hands, solve our own problems, but say, God, I don't see the way out. I don't have a clue what's next, but I'm trusting you. You know what's best for me. And God, in the midst of our wilderness, would you remind us, people are watching. May our response in the midst of our wilderness be a faith witness. May people look at us and say, they are going through the valley, but their spirit is sweet. They're not bitter. They're not angry. They have a gentle spirit. And let that witness point people to you. So Lord, this morning, though we don't like the witness, thank you for the wilderness, we thank you for the wilderness. Shape us and mold us more and more into your image, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord bless you today as you walk through whatever wilderness you're in. Remember, people are watching. Next week, we plan to look at 23rd Psalm. Blessings on you. Go live out your faith.